Parental discretion is advised.
Find yourself in the Beachview area of Pittsburgh? Check out the official pizza of this show, Slice on Broadway, sharing an abnormal obsession with pizza we can relate to. Check them out at sliceonbroadway.com and tell them this show sent you. Want to have your business or podcast featured on the show? Contact us at info@sorgatronmedia.com. Subject line, advertising. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Wrestling Mayhem Show 493, the Halloween edition. Thank you to the Dutters for our awesome intro there. If you guys are on the video version, if you're on the audio, go check out the video version. Trust me.
She's not wrong.
She's not wrong. No, it's not that one. It's the other video that you're talking about.
Oh.
It's that other video on our Facebook page you're talking about the pants.
Oh. Yeah.
But find out about Dutters and the pants on the YouTube. What? Anyways, this is your Wrestling Mayhem Show. We talk about, not technology, we talk about professional wrestling. I'm here live. I'm Mike Sorg at Sorgatron on the Twitters, live from the Mayhem Studios in Pittsburgh, PA. And I got a very Pennsylvania-based lineup with me tonight because I'm trying to get that pop screen. I don't know. How does Kane wrestle in this thing? How does this work? But anyways, I am Intellectual Kane tonight, obviously. And with me on the line from the deep and nether reaches of the Pittsburgh region, it is Papa Lunchbox.
Hello, Sorgatron. Unfortunately, I have passed on to the spirit realm.
Oh,
but the good news is they have bitchin' Wi-Fi here.
Cool.
Have you noticed that hauntings are way down worldwide? This is the reason. I'm streaming 42 Netflix movies at this very moment. Don't worry about me being distracted, though, as I am now one with the infinite.
There you go. Also with us, speaking of nether realm type areas, from Johnstown, PA, it is Bobby FJ Town.
We held our Halloween party today.
Oh.
Not party, parade.
Ooh.
Parade. Mm-hmm. And there was a wrestling show in Windsor, Pennsylvania, where I'm actually from, this weekend. And I saw a man with a power glove. So that was a thing.
And that was this week in Johnstown, PA, with Bobby FJ Town.
Yeah,
also
yeah.
With us from the other side of Pittsburgh, it is the Riz of Riz Plays Games.
Hi, Sorg. So you mentioned you're an intellectual Kane, correct?
Intellectual Kane. See, I have the glasses.
Is that does
that make you Dean Kane?
Well, folks, it's been a good episode, good Wrestling Mayhem Show.
Thank you.
WrestlingMayhem.com. Call us 412-263.
I was thinking Intellectual Kane would be like the gremlin.
What did you learn in wrestling this week, Sorg?
I was thinking the Intellectual Kane would be the Kane that, or like the gremlin that drank the serum that made him smart.
Well, this has been the Wrestling Mayhem Show. This is you can check us out. We're at WrestlingMayhemShow.com. You can subscribe to us on the iTunes, Stitcher, Spreaker, and soon you can actually subscribe to us over on Google Play. We are applying for that right now, so we should launch alongside that here very soon. You can also follow us on the social media at Mayhem Show. Follow us on the Facebook, on the Google Plus, on the Facebook group where we have a lot. And let me know. Should we have a Wrestling Mayhem Show subreddit? Let me know if you're interested in that. I understand that's the cool thing to do if you're a podcast, but I wasn't sure since everybody's on the Facebook group if it makes sense to also have a Reddit. Are you a Reddit user? Apparently Tony Garza was. He got me really, really into Reddit today, actually, with his list that he gave me. I feel like I have no eyeballs when I look into the camera. Is this weird? There they are. I found my eyes. Okay. But anyways, and you can also do other things to communicate with us. You can drop us a line to the 412-206-WMS0. That is our voicemail hotline, just like the Carlin sisses joined us a couple weeks ago, or actually last week, about their how they felt about what was going on in the world of wrestling. And you can also drop us a line to the email address.
Good times
at WrestlingMayhemShow.com. And please check out the music from our buddy Basic Sickness at BasicSickness.com. and free music, free videos, and he has a new album. If it's not out yet, it didn't hit me up yet. Very soon, if not. So go check him out. He's been a good friend of projects around here for a good long time. And if you're digging what you're seeing here on the Wrestling Mayhem Show, or what you're hearing, you can join our scores and scores of patrons over at patreon.com/WrestlingMayhemShow, or just click the links on the YouTube channel or on WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Big thanks to Jen Carlins as a Patreon supporter, Ed Burke, who joins us and converses with us a whole lot up there on the Twitters as well. AJ, or wait, who's AJ? Because his name is
AJ.
Diggity! Woo! As well as the great WrestlingRevolution.com, TheWrestlingRevolution.com, Antonio Garza, the longest running Patreon supporter from down there in Texas. Thank you so much. Everybody that supports their show gets behind the show, and you help us pay the bills around here. So hey, we're almost at the zero point of being a negative profit podcast. It's pretty cool. Go check all that stuff out, support the shows and everything like that. So let's get into our topics of the evening. Of course, Hell in a Cell just happened this past weekend. A lot going on. We talked a lot last night about kind of the state of WWE, and we did get a little bit into Hell in a Cell and the state of the storylines and the state of the people involved, and the people that aren't around anymore, and Mexican Americans and all that kind of stuff. But I want to talk about The Undertaker right now, obviously. The 25th anniversary of The Undertaker at the Survivor Series this year. Obviously, some big, big stuff happening around The Undertaker and his associates and the Wyatt family. So I want to put to you guys, what do you think about this? Where do you think this is going? How do you properly do a retrospective with The Undertaker after 25 years at the event that gave birth to The Undertaker? LB?
That's a lot of questions you just asked. That's many, many questions, and they all have great answers, probably. I'm into the Wyatt thing. I think it's interesting. I've always said that, you know, for them to be a cult, they have to recruit people. Mm-hmm. And this will make the second time they've stolen Kane, if I'm not mistaken. And they stole The Undertaker. And I just hope that something comes of this. You know what I mean? Whether it's a new ministry of darkness or a Kane cult or Undertaker cult or whatever, I hope they do something with it. Instead of Kane just showing back up like last time. He's fine. Everybody just hung out with the Wyatts, and now he's fine. I want something interesting to come of this.
What about you, Riz, Bobby?
Honestly. This is something for Bray to do. He's done with Roman Reigns, so why not go back to The Undertaker, which he's lost to, but then build something towards it. Make it seem like it's a passing of the torch type situation, where this may be the last Survivor Series that The Undertaker will have, more than likely, because this pomp and circumstances of, hey, this is the 25 year anniversary of The Undertaker debuting. Like, that day is the anniversary. So this is going to probably be your last time seeing The Undertaker. So why not have somebody as twisted and batshit and like undead type person beat the guy who started all that and beat The Undertaker, or do something with The Undertaker and maybe take the crown or pass a torch or just do what Bray Wyatt does and lose to The Undertaker.
I think it's going to lead to a Survivor Series style match where The Undertaker won't have much to do in the match other than come in and maybe either win it or just look good. You know, they're not going to have him, and they can save him for WrestleMania for his probably final match in Texas, I'm thinking.
I see it two ways, and I pointed this out on the Hangout. It's either going to be that Survivor Series match, or it's going to be a gimmick singles match with Bray Wyatt, whether it's a casket match.
Buried alive.
Buried alive. Something that he is known for, because we already saw the Hell in a Cell match, which he was, you know, part in getting to the WWE.
Buried Alive Survivor Series match.
Oh God, that'll like be worse.
Four graves.
No, they'll just have one grave like they did with the tag match one.
It's like musical chairs, but with graves.
But having just like maybe one match with Bray Wyatt and having some symbolic gesture or something to go along with that would be cool to see again in WWE. But I'm leaning more towards the singles match than I am for the Survivor Series for some reason. I don't know why. Bobby, you make good points, but I don't see him just doing it for Survivor Series, like just a Survivor Series style match. I think he wants to do some. I think they want him to do something fun, something memorable for his last one, for his 25th anniversary. Mm-hmm. So unless they bring back Rhythm and Blues and the Honky and the Million Dollar Man, I just don't see it like occurring for him to do another Survivor Series style match.
I love that you brought it, because I was racking my brain trying to figure out who he teamed with. Now, who's on the other side? Do you remember who's on the other side of this one?
Oh, man.
Isn't Dusty on the other side, unfortunately?
I think it was Dusty. We watched this on the when we first started doing that live
the watch parties.
Thing, the watch parties. I forget who was on the other side. I'm going to look it up, sorry, because now I'm interested.
How did you come in?
Continue on with the
like, that's what, because I've had my theories, starting with, of course, Brothers of Destruction and the Shield, Roman and Ambrose would be Roman's a good team up for a Survivor Series match, but obviously that's going in a different direction. I wanted Kane to be a Manchurian King, because he got carried off at SummerSlam, 2 years ago now? And he, of course, he just came back, and there was no like, well, what happened, right? Like, Undertaker got carried off, and we don't know what happened. Kane just got carried off. Are they just going to show up another week and we're like, we're going to get you for carrying us off awkwardly? You know, what's the point here? Plus, why does nobody care? And they're looking for these people. I know they're like demon Kanes.
Leslie Nelson's dead. So
yes. Oh no.
He's the only person that cared to search for the Undertaker when he was missing. Nobody else does.
That's true. I guess so. I guess so. But like, I kind of wanted the whole like you know, maybe they're up against the Taker, and Kane comes out for the save, and Wyatt does a signal, and Kane just turns on his brother because he's been mind washed from when they carried him away. But then again, it didn't work on Daniel Bryan. Right? Like,
all right.
Yeah, that was a trap.
Yeah. All right. You ready for the team?
Okay.
I found it is Dusty Rhodes who led it. It was the dream. It was the dream team with Dusty Rhodes, Coco Beware.
What?
Bret Hart and Jim Neidhart.
Oh.
Wow.
Not a bad team.
So
a lot of Hall of Famers.
He beat three Hall of Famers on his first night. Amazing.
Bring them all back. Have them just tombstone them all. Have them just tombstone.
Well,
like, you can't bring Dusty back.
Oh, well, except for Dusty, of course. But still
probably Jim Neidhart, who's in rehab somewhere.
Yeah, he's in rehab. Brett's had strokes. Yeah, this isn't.
Yeah, maybe
the curse of the Undertaker.
Maybe it's a good thing not to do that. Sort
so, what do you want to see? What you want to see? The casket match? You want to see a Survivor Series type match? Or you just want to see, you know, a Wyatt and Bray thing? Or, I'm sorry, a Bray and Bret Taker thing happen? What do you think makes sense here? Maybe we just get down to Wyatt and one of his guys against Brothers of Destruction, or maybe we get a 4-on-2 match just for the hell of it.
That would be difficult.
If this is like the last stand of the Undertaker, the last we're going to see of him, I wouldn't be surprised if we didn't see any kind of match. You know what I mean? Like, it's traditional for when a wrestler is, leaving the company or retiring or whatever, he has his retirement match. You know what I mean? But this is the Undertaker. He can do whatever he wants. If he just wants to, you know, come out, do his thing, and disappear in a flash of lightning, he can. I think that would be better than a final match.
And that's why I see a casket match or a buried alive match where they can have these that vignette that they always remember against Yokozuna when he lost. They had all those like the image inside the casket of the Undertaker, and he's talking to you. Mm-hmm. They can have something like that.
Or when he rose from the dead.
Yeah, when he rose from the dead and in the silhouette of the Undertaker.
And it was flat and 2D.
But they can have something like that. They can do something like that, make him go over even when he loses the match. If he loses the match, would be good to have for both Bray, who takes a step towards finally winning a feud, and the Undertaker for, you know, just stepping aside, because he's the Undertaker and he's not going to, like, I don't want to see him go, but for the past few matches we've seen him, he looked dead tired. Mm-hmm. And he looked like he was on the verge of passing out multiple times. So if this is the last time we see the Undertaker, I'd like it to see more of a symbolic type dead man gesture, and not just a, oh, I'm just going to leave now. Bye. And just go away.
My planet needs me. And then he does that 2D lifting thing again.
I think I'm thinking back to that, cause I remember that moment. And I think that was the point where I was just like, maybe wrestling's not real.
I just picture the Undertaker drinking that fizzy lifting drink from Charlie and the Chocolate.
Wow.
It gives you wings, right, Taker?
It's just burping.
Know. Let us know your thoughts on the position of the Undertaker, what they're doing here, and your thoughts on Hell in a Cell, of course. We had many of them. We talked about a lot of them on the Facebook group, of course, and on a little bit of the Raw wrap-up last night. I don't know where to put these glasses. There's this actually a bump here in this mask, and so it doesn't really like rest anywhere. So I don't know how this all works, but I love that it perfectly conforms around my goatee.
Kane. Sergey Kane.
It does look like late or 2000s Kane when he came out in that mask and had the goatee on it.
I'm getting dizzy.
It's got to be Kane.
Getting dizzy from doing this.
Don't pass out, Sergey.
If I pass out, you're just stuck on whatever shot I'm on, which is probably just me hunched over the desk. And, you know, well, that's not depressing. Let's move on.
Maybe Terry Funk could come back.
Sorg, why are you going to pass out?
I don't know, because I'm getting dizzy. I'm getting a little dizzy.
You need a carbon monoxide detector.
Yeah.
The silent but deadly killer.
So go check out our friends over at indiewrestling.us. Hey, you know, indie wrestling's pretty cool. We don't have it on the site, but apparently, but we do have on Around the Indies, the fact that it's 2015, and apparently Terry Funk threw a fireball at Jerry Lawler somewhere.
Terry Funk.
Other way around.
I just mentioned him. They should bring him back.
Other way around, sort
of. Oh, Undertaker. Lawler threw it at Terry Funk?
Terry Lawler threw it at Terry
Funk.
Wow. So
Jerry Lawler is a demon.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
he's got damn demon powers.
Jerry Lawler.
So that's the kind of fun you can see. Our own Matt Carlins has this wonderful Around the Indies post, so you can see what's going on in the world. And one, Terry Funk is wrestling again in 2015 because
he wrestled in another retirement match. Everybody,
is that what this is?
That's another retirement match.
Oh, geez.
I fought Jerry Lawler, and a loser has to build a treehouse and cut his firstborn child out of it.
He's beating up referees left and right, and apparently, eventually, I'm trying to get to that point where we actually see this. Hold on, what's going on? Oh, apparently it happened.
Oh,
It's coming up here. But no, we got a lot of great stuff here. We're looking at a lot of the indies, and of course, there's a lot of... there it is, and he's on fire.
Ooh,
oh, there it is. Man. That did not look good. But we got a lot of fun stuff over here. We have some Canadian stuff that's come on the site in recent weeks. We're actually carrying Border City Wrestling right on the front page there. East meets West, their crossover show with New Japan Pro Wrestling, as well as Excellence with Bret Hart because it's Canada. Rhino, who's shown up recently, and some other names. There's Scott Steiner. And, of course, the great stuff like RWA's Bloody Harvest with the three-way of Gory, Amazing Red, and Sanjay Dutt. IWC's Unbreakable, including Rhino is on here. And so much more. Digital downloads, individual matches for $1.99, sometimes 99 cents. Best of Dalton Castle, The Rise of the Peacock, Volume 1 and 2. See him before he was in Ring of Honor with the boys. And so much more. Death match with VOW, the Lord of Anarchy tournament that's been making its rounds on the YouTubes lately as well. So go check that out. Support indie wrestling, support indiewrestling.us, and support the show. So let's get into, so there's a new show that started this past week on the WWE Network. It's called Breaking Ground. The long goodbye, because we know somebody who's definitely getting fired if you're up with your news lately. Triple H is going away. That's right. So
he was released this morning, but they filled all this stuff.
Gonna be Mojo Raleigh. I'm gonna be Mojo Raleigh.
Sure.
Daniel Seaman took him in the office, and he's like, "Triple H, I'm sorry,
not Mojo Raleigh. Is it Mojo Raleigh?"
It's not Mojo Raleigh. I don't think it's Brojo Raleigh. But we got an email here. Some thoughts from our boy Mad Mike with some thoughts on it. And Eamon's in the chat room as well. I'm sure he's going to chime in on his thoughts. So, hey, Eamon, give me your initial thoughts in the chat room. And anybody else who may have seen the show that's joining us live, that live.wrestlingmayhemshow.com here tonight. He says, Mad Mike says, "Greeting, Mayhemers. It's that guy who not only enjoyed Breaking Ground but loved a Raw without Cena or Orton around. It's Mad Mike." Okay, so I've got two major things I want to touch on this week. First of all, our new U.S. champion. Wait, this isn't about Breaking Ground. All right, we'll touch on this part later. Briefly on Breaking Ground. I thought the whole thing was going to be about Breaking Ground. Briefly about Breaking Ground. I was a little disappointed with the show. It was only a half an hour, but it will still be. But it was still really fun to watch. It was cool seeing the real trainers as opposed to the part-time Tough Enough trainers there. I could watch the whole season of Regal coaching promo classes. Yes, it's a touch odd that we are focusing so much on people who have been on TV, but it also seems ominous given that Triple H said some don't make it. The preview for the rest of the season seems extremely compelling, and I hope they bring this back after the first 10 episode run. One final question for the group: do you think Breaking Ground type shows for the main roster would work, or would it get muddled in the travel and hubbub of live TV? I think your answer is Total Divas.
Mm-hmm.
For that question.
What was the question? I'm sorry.
Would you think
I didn't follow it.
Would you think a Breaking Ground type show work for a main looking at main roster competitors, or would they get muddled in the live TV schedule, I guess?
I think yes, because of the success of the ESPN specials that they did.
Right, mm-hmm. Right.
I feel like that that might be why they're going in this direction of the Breaking Ground stuff, because that was so talked about and so successful.
But I think we already have something like that with the Table for Three, where they have all those short little increments of just three wrestlers talking. Just having them talk about the road and talking about how they got there and talking about how they do that.
And that's
one of the most successful things they have on there.
Yeah.
I just finished watching the Brass Rings episode, which is amazing. Just having those guys talk about their indie experience and how they're now just sitting in a empty room eating expensive food on WWE's budget.
They didn't give Dean Ambrose a knife.
No, they didn't. He just ate that. So I think if they do something like maybe more like what the Road Diaries are, with the one that's Colt Cabana and Kikitaru doing, something like that, just having them doing stuff on the road. They don't have to have scripts. They don't have to do anything like that. They can just be themselves. And that's what Breaking – I almost said Breaking Ground.
Breaking Bad.
Yeah, Breaking Bad. But that's what Proving Ground or Proving
– Breaking Ground.
Breaking Ground. You had it right.
Whatever it was. Whatever that show was, that's why it's successful, because it's not Total Divas, and it's just not scripted. It's not really that scripted. like Total Divas is.
I found this show generally refreshing after we got through Tough Enough. Mm-hmm. Like it was just like, oh, thank you. Like this is for real. This is what it's like. As far as like who we're following, I really don't think we're gonna follow these people throughout the entire season. I think we're gonna touch on a ton of people here and there throughout the season. I think for an episode, we're going to look at Baron Corbin, what he's about. We're going to look at this person and what that's about. You know, we had a minute with Bayley, right? I think it's just going to be about the process and what's happening here in general, right?
It looks
by
like
way, by the way, Bayley in the Mario shirt. Perfect.
Hmm. What was that, Bobby?
It looks like Dana Brooke's going to have like a part in it. They talked to her about something. I think they talked to Mojo a little bit in this one. They showed like one of his promos, which whatever, it's Mojo.
Why do you have to bring that up, Bobby?
I don't know, because I'm tired of staying hype.
Stay hype.
But anyways, but yeah, I enjoyed Grounded for Life. I thought it was a good.
We're just gonna come up with weird.
I enjoyed it. I enjoyed watching it. I thought it was really good. It's cool to see like behind the curtain, stuff like that. It gave me an appreciation for like Baron Corbin that I didn't have before. Like he is working hard, you know, and he does seem like a smug asshole, but that's his character. Like I thought Mojo was more of an asshole to him.
Because he is.
Yeah. He was like, oh, what are you eating there, Corbin? What are you eating? You know, I was like, let him eat and enjoy his meal. He doesn't have to help set up the ring like everybody else.
Yeah, that was kind of a weird sequence.
I think Mojo thinks that when the camera's on, he's supposed to be in character.
Yeah.
Not for this.
Maybe he's just like that all the time. Maybe. He's friends with Gronk.
Just hype all the time?
He's just hype all the time, yeah. Maybe they should give him Ritalin.
Listen, Mojo, we think you're doing good work, but you need to calm this shit down.
Yeah. Vince is backstage. Give that guy Ritalin. It's Ritalin.
You gotta calm down, Mojo.
Okay. What did you guys think about our choice of narrator for the series?
It reminds me of Rescue 911.
Wait, they got Tom Lennon to narrate the series?
No,
that's Reno 911.
Reno 911.
Wait, they got William Shatner?
Yeah, William Shatner.
No, that's Tech World.
Yeah, Tech Wars.
Tech Wars. No, you're, I don't even know what the joke is.
How that's made.
What?
I don't know. This is the
what
best
is even
thing
happening
ever.
Right now? All right, no more commentary on William Shatner. Apparently, we had some comments from the chat room. Everybody's chiming in. Garza thinks that was a huge commercial on how WWE is taking care of concussions. Well, yeah, it does. It definitely helps there. I mean, everything's supposed to make them look good. Let's be honest about this, right? But he also says it's also a kayfabe breaker since we get to see Bayley in tight short dresses.
Mm-hmm. Not complaining.
That beginning shot though, Bayley. Yeah.
Okay.
That's nice.
Okay.
That's nice.
Okay.
Very nice. My wife.
Eamon says that the 100% would work and would create investment in characters that don't have it right now, forcing people to watch more as far as the reality side of things. Yeah, I think it'll be interesting. You know, maybe you care a little more if you followed Zack Ryder. You're like, okay, what does Zack Ryder do here? But you know, but exactly, like, because you guys, I mean, on this show, I feel like a lot of people have the impression of, well, he's not on Raw, therefore he ain't doing crap in this company, and there's no reason for him being there. You know, the question, what does The Miz do? Well, The Miz is off doing these other things. Like, somebody needs to do it. Somebody has to be the ambassador and do these other spots on the shows, right? And go do movies and these kinds of things. It's not always about getting to WrestleMania or being on the pay-per-view or on Raw, right? There's a lot of other positions, a lot of people populate in this company. So,
I also like that we're getting to see Sarah Del Rey shape the future of the women's wrestling.
Oh, it's so great to see, like, her and Norman Smiley in there talking about it. Yeah. And even Albert... you know, talking about the philosophy and how it's working, it gives more insight on what it takes to be a pro wrestler than Tough Enough ever did.
Yeah,
right? I mean, that they went in and talked about the tradition and setting up the ring and everything, and how you never really get a look at those indie shows that they basically put on in Florida. And that's what they are, because they have people on the shows that don't really attract anybody, right? Mm-hmm. You know, even as it is, and there's probably so many of those shows that there's not like everybody in Florida flocking to one place. They're doing a circuit, right? They're doing a monthly or whatever the case may be. So there is only like 50, 100 people in the crowds, because that's what they're attracting. But they're doing it low budget, and it works, and it gets these people experience regardless. And they can test out things without bringing them to Raw, for instance. So. No, I think it's really good. I think it's a really good show. And we'll see how it develops. And it's nice to see them utilizing one performance center to kind of dig in way deeper into this training NXT stuff that everybody can't get enough of these days. And it'll be good to see kind of where that goes from there. And we have a picture of Bailey in a dress in the chat room. But here, aiming on that other idea. Like, if we knew what Roman Reigns' actual story was and he was humanized, I'm sure we would. He'd be much more favored upon. Tell those people stories, and people will watch them wrestle. I think it could seriously fix the constantly declining ratings. Well, that's kind of like the Finn Balor thing, of course. I think we've talked about. And isn't that, well, they did that with Roman Reigns. They did that with the Usos, with the 24/7 stuff. They did that with Booker T. I think they did one on.
Yeah.
So why aren't we getting more? The answer is probably budget and maybe response to those, how many people watch those specials. But, you could definitely populate that. And maybe that is, you know, the Table for Three does that a lot, too, like you mentioned before. So we are getting a lot of that background insight. They're pulling up the curtain. And I think the super fans are just eating it up, and other people are being exposed to what it's really like around there. So, and who these people really are. So.
I always found it really interesting when they decide to, you know, kind of break kayfabe for the interest of profit, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Not for legal reasons, essentially. I have a book that's road stories from various professional wrestlers from like the early 2000s, the early aughts. Mm-hmm. And I just find it interesting that they will release things like this, and it's becoming more and more common. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm.
Right. Well, I think more has to do with like other. There's more examples out there now for how to do like shows. There's podcasts out there with wrestlers, like the Art of Wrestling, like JR's podcast, like everything like that. Mm-hmm. And all they do is tell stories about what happened to them and why they are where they're at, and that's what they're trying to do now. And it has a WWE spin to it, but it's still their words. Still how they got into it and how they did it. And I think that's what more people want to hear. Mm-hmm. How Cesaro got in there, how Kevin Owens wanted to go, how like road stories from Dean Ambrose or
Cesaro. The fans can't connect with him.
No, but with guys like the New Day or something like that. That's why the 24/7 or WWE 24s worked. That's why the Table for Three worked. That's why Ground Chuck is working. That's why everything is working for the WWE in the aspect of just having something that the fans can connect to.
Look what that 360 special did to not 360 E60 special did for Adam Rose. Like, it actually had people believing in Adam Rose for a second, and now they didn't really do anything. They didn't do anything to capitalize on it though, which is kind of sad because he's a good wrestler. He seems like a good dude, you know. But maybe they're trying to get him over with this new gimmick, but I don't see it working.
No, I has the gimmick appeared anywhere except for on like
superstars?
yeah, not enough. All right, well, let us know what you guys think as we get through the weeks here on Breaking Ground. I'm sure there's interesting things come out of this show. We'll talk about more. I don't know, maybe we'll do a Breaking Ground wrap up of some sort somewhere along the network. We'll be talking about that, and of course we'll be discussing things on all of our social media platforms, so please follow us on all of that. In the meantime, hey, you getting hungry yet? It's a long show. Maybe you're in the South Hills of Pittsburgh and you want to pick up some Slice on Broadway. You all right over there? Slice on Broadway.
I forgot you were wearing the mask and I brought up the window with your video. I got freaked out for a second.
Kane's like, are you hungry yet?
It looks like you're the guy from... It looks like you're the guy from Big Bang Theory.
Take a bite of my fruit roll-up face.
Wow. No,
pizza sword, pizza.
Don't eat your fruit roll up face. It's starting to hurt my nose, actually. Go to SliceOnBroadway.com here in the South Hills of Pittsburgh, right along the tracks here in Beachview, as well as on the main street in Carnegie, Pennsylvania. Check them out. Fresh stuff. Rico, right there on the front page, is the man behind the revolution, the pizza revolution. Great gourmet pizzas. Definitely recommend. You can have a beer with it. Whatever the case may be. Check them out. Great people. Been great to us and have been supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with pepperoni pizza perfectly for well over a year here. Thank you so much to them. And now let's take first a special message from our friend Dutters. You saw at the beginning, if you're on the video version of this, or maybe you saw it on our Facebook or our YouTube or our Twitter this week. And I'll take a look back at last week.
This! Look at him with his guess who looking face. Does he have curly hair? Yes. Does he have a dumb face? Yes. Does he owe Sawtooth money? Yes, he do! Tommy James old Sawtooth money! That's real nice, though. I appreciate the reminder. Oh, and there's the money.
Tracy, and he does rants about sports, and you know, I like to think of it as an art piece. One time it would be great. He probably would be in MoMA with it if he just would only do it one time, but he does it, you know, twice a month.
We're gonna have the Gold's Gym Mod Chalk, the Taco Bell sponsored Hitman Lee.
Boba Fett brought to you by Fiber One. Can do it.
The Slowpoke Pizza Hut.
The workers have a way, you know, it's like the cream always rises to the top. Stir your coffee up, that foam's going to come up. And that's where the best workers are going to come from, your best wrestlers, your best athletes. They're going to come out and they're going to truly shine. And so they expose themselves just like the others do.
And I'm worried they're going to try to start pushing things.
It just wants to be helpful, man.
Yeah. Listen,
I understand you're trying to be helpful.
The big goog wants to help you out in your day-to-day life, okay? The big goog is looking out for you, okay? And watching you.
And reading your emails.
And reading your emails. And knows exactly where you are.
The WWE and myself, it's like a bad relationship. Bad enough where you know you need to get out. They're showing you everything that you want to see.
Okay.
You know what? You're all like a sweet bug. I just want to get screwed. Not that way. Can I swear?
We are back. It is the Wrestling Mayhem Show, and it is time for the biggest of big questions with Papa Lunchbox. Today, for Halloween, dressed as Papa Lunchbox.
It's true. I am wearing my Papa Lunchbox costume.
From right to center, it looks like.
Hey, right to center won. The PG era is in the WWE. They brought in the PG era. I'm sorry.
It's interesting that you should mention the PG era, Bobby, because on the pay-per-view on Sunday, we had something happen that was decidedly un-PG, and that was a lot of blood.
Mm.
Blood, and then more blood, and then additional amounts of blood. Now, it's been speculated that Vince was grumpy but didn't yell at anybody, and you know they didn't get in trouble they were busted open. And it wasn't intentional. They didn't blade or whatever like that, But the point is that it was a high profile match and there was a breathtaking amount of blood. So my question to you is, have the times changed so much that there's no place for it? Is there a place for blood in wrestling today?
Yes. Certainly. If it happens naturally.
Yeah.
If it happens to happen in like an instance where somebody botches or something like that, yeah, they should have like the scar on, like they should bleed from like from their head or from their hand or whoever. It shows that they actually that something happened. It shows there's something actually going on. The Brock Lesnar and I believe Undertaker did too. They got it the hard way. They did it the hard way. So I don't see where all the big fuss about it is. Brock Lesnar, I believe, had 9 stitches or 9 staples in his head after the match, I believe. But if it happens to be something, maybe like, we don't need the Attitude Era where every match blades. We don't need somebody to look like Devon's head with all the little marks in his, all the little scrapes in his head from blading so much. We don't need that. It looks real when somebody bleeds for real, because it's happening. It means something's happening. It means something like something hit someone's head really hard to cause something to do that. Mm-hmm. So yeah, if it happens right, if it happens naturally, yes. Sorry, I sounded like I was angry there.
But now he seems very angry. So if it's natural, yes. But if it's artificial, no.
Yes.
Okay. I think if it helps to tell the story, I think it's okay to bleed. Like one of the most famous matches in WWE history where we got the t-shirt of Stone Cold with blood like running down his face. I think the shirt was like blood from a stone or something like that. Like that match right there was like put Stone Cold on the map almost. You know, it was one of his high profile matches. Do you think it would have been the same if he wouldn't have bled?
He would have passed out?
He passed out anyways. Yeah, he passed out. But do you think it would have been as effective without the blood?
Probably, maybe not as much, but it'd still be very effective.
Mm-hmm. But I don't think they should blade on purpose, though. I agree on that. But if it happens, it happens. You know, there's nothing you can really do about it. I know they're trying to be safe about everything by sending the doctors in the match, but it kind of does stop the momentum.
No, that's liability purposes.
Yeah. Yeah. But for Brock to shove the doctor away.
Yeah, that might be a little much. Yeah. I find the both blood spots in the Hell in a Cell suspicious. I saw stuff that I think was blading in my visual experience of this stuff. I don't know. It could be, you know, but I saw stuff that was like, it looks like he's doing a thing in a couple of instances. And
did Brock get like busted open when he hit the post?
Well,
he didn't hit the post that hard.
He didn't. Mm-hmm. And even, you know, I'm kind of catching up here. Like they commented on how he blocked it and it looked like he mostly blocked it. And again, he had his hand up like this,
but
which is
his hand was here, but the mark was on his top.
Oh,
of his
no,
head,
he still could have from there. I think he still could have from there from the way he was standing. And there was another point where I swear I saw Undertaker when he was down on the ground after taking a couple of hits to the face, go like this on his head. I thought I saw. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe not. I don't know. And I think at least, if nothing else, we're only getting this on these high-profile matches, like the highest of high-profile matches, right? Like the Brock Lesnar match. I mean, you can't. Brock seems to bleed every match. It seems now, right? The big ones, at least, you know. And I think that definitely enhances it, makes it feel real, makes it feel legitimate. I don't hate it for that, as long as like everybody agrees on it. And again, you know, this article I'm bringing up with SB Nation is talking about how you know this is foolish in the day of Hep C and everything like that. But you know, there's testing and everything like that. You know, there's still the death matches happening in West Virginia, and it looks like the referee is ready for like hazmat with the gloves and the glasses and everything like that.
Well, they're in West Virginia.
I mean, I would wear that to go into West Virginia anyways. But they don't have podcasts in West Virginia, right?
I fought in a West Virginia hazmat match.
But anyways, you know, it's I think we're in a day where no, you don't need it that much. We've been conditioned away from it. You can't get pissed anymore when Hell in a Cell doesn't have blood. And I think the Wyatt and Roman match was a perfect example of a very well done and brutal filling match that did not have blood. That's okay. Mm-hmm. And you really can't anymore. You just really can't anymore. And I don't know. I think we're at a stage where that's okay for them, especially that old school mentality, but not for basically anybody else, which is good for these guys coming up, to be quite honest.
Someone found the blood codes backstage for the video game.
Exactly.
They turned it on.
Exactly. And but
did everybody go?
I think everybody went. I know. Will, what did you think? LB, what did you think?
No.
My answer
is no. There was a time and a place where blood was appropriate and it was excellent and it was well done and it was all over the place and it was brutal and savage and it enhanced matches that it was in and it elevated otherwise mediocre matches. But I think now there are too many talented wrestlers and there is too much good wrestling to need to lean on a crutch like that, like blading. You can have an incredible 5-star match without introducing blood into it, and it's more of a challenge that way. And it's happening. It's happening all over the place. I think the wrestlers we have on the roster right now are some of the most talented wrestlers that WWE has ever had. And there's a number of them who aren't being utilized, and they don't need to blade because they enhance the matches in other ways. So no, I think the time of blood has passed.
But what if something like the way I see it is, you guys remember on, I believe the first takeover Kevin Owens was on.
Mm-hmm.
He got busted open first. That was not blading, but it told us it showed how tough that guy is.
Well, it's like when Sami Zayn got like legit injured in his match with John Cena. It enhanced the story, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it made an even greater story.
So blading, yes, I agree with you, Lunchbox. That blading doesn't need to come back. It needs to stay away in the attitude era with Naked Midian and everything else that went along with it. But if something happens like that, like a freak accident, like John Cena getting his nose busted open, or something else very dangerous happening, then yeah, it should tell a story, and it should drive that story too.
Mm-hmm.
Like it shouldn't just be done for effect like blading was. And that's why I kind of disagree with Bobby when he said that it wouldn't be the same if Stone Cold just passed out. Like yes, it would have, because it's a submission hold and you pass, like people pass out on submission.
Blood loss.
Right. It makes it way more serious, right?
Yeah.
I like to think that Brock Lesnar and Undertaker just have baby fingernails that are like razor sharp, and they just couldn't help it, you know. Sharp as baby claws.
We have anything with the chat room sword?
Nothing particularly about the blood, other than here we are. We have a little bit more coming in right now. It says Garza is saying that blood is not about having a 5-star match, but about the level of hate and intensity of a feud. Mm-hmm. Some feuds require an extra amount of violence.
I get that, but blading and just going like this across your head doesn't really enhance the hatred towards one another.
Oh, I hate you so much.
Yeah, I'm just going to do this to my own head because it tells that story of hatred. If you want something to hate something, just hit them over the head with something and they'll bleed.
You make me want to cut myself like a teenager.
Sorry. I get angry sometimes, Sorg.
So angry he's going to start cutting himself?
Yeah.
You're going to start cut bleeding yourself? Anyways.
It's been a long week, Sorg.
It's been a long week. All right. Well, with that, if you let us know what you think about the state of blading, if it has any place right now in pro wrestling, and you can hashtag WMS Big Question, and it will give you a chance to win a copy of the Best of Dalton Castle Volume 2 on digital download. Oh, damn. All right, Bobby?
Can I have it?
Yeah.
I want it.
Bobby, you're going to have to participate in this. We'll put you in the drawing for this. Hashtag what?
Hashtag find Riz.
Oh yeah, Riz should be in the audience for a lot of that stuff.
Oh actually. Yeah,
mm-hmm. You might recognize some cameramen along the way too. So there's that as well. That's our big question. Please support the show. Hey, we're up at prowrestlingtees.com/WMS. There's a lot going on. A lot of people with their awesome pro wrestling tee stores got a really good shirt today about. Jim Ross of all people. It was the it had the date of, oh my god, I think he's broken in half. And God Almighty. Yeah. And I know he was retweeting that today. But you can start at prowrestlingtees.com/WMS. Support the show. Buy some Wrestling Mayhem Show tees. Thank you to Pro Wrestling Tees for retweeting our tweet about our shirts and helping to get that out there, and everybody else that did as well. So please do that. Hey, we got a little bit more email from Mad Mike that I skipped earlier. So I figured we'd stick it here and see if there's more thoughts before we get to what we learned this week in wrestling. So he says he's got one of his two major things. There's our new U.S. champion, which we have not discussed this really at length here. Now, we all knew that Cena was going to be losing the belt in Hell in a Cell, right? But why did we waste who the rub was going to go to? Alberto coming back for whatever reason, cough, millions of dollars, cough, was a fantastic surprise, but Alberto doesn't need the belt to be over. There are at least a half dozen guys who have done well with a clean win over Cena for a championship. The recently debuting Tyler Breeze could be one of those people, or Neville Stardust Cesaro. He could go on, but he won't. If you still want Alberto to debut as a surprise, you can have Cena come out the night after and congratulate the winner before he can call for a rematch. Alberto comes out and takes him out, then accomplishes two goals, not just one. What are your thoughts? I'm thinking it didn't really need to rub a new thing. I mean, the rub was a reintroduction for Alberto, right?
Yeah, right. I was fine with that. It was a great match.
It was a reintroduction to both Alberto and Zeb Colter.
Exactly.
Yeah, right, so I think it did accomplish a lot. I don't think it's a big deal that it didn't go to I didn't go to like an NXT guy or something, right?
Cena had a great series of matches with those guys, and it got them talked about. I mean, it did wonders for their careers. You know, I mean, he did lose to them, or they did lose to him, but I don't know. I was fine with Alberto.
Yeah, I thought it was a great idea. Mm-hmm. Like you said, you know, it reintroduces us to Alberto and Deb, and it's him coming back to the company is exciting anyway, and then adding this other layer of him now taking the title from John Cena in a great match, gravy.
All right, what's that, Riz?
No, I just agree with you guys 100% on this one. It was a good thing to reintroduce those guys, and make sure they know that these guys now like each other. Because remember, Zeb and Del Rio were hated each other for about a year. So why not have them team up and just say, hey, let's put aside our differences with, you know, Jack Swagger and just go on by herself, because nobody cares about Jack Swagger
except for Marth.
Right,
not even Marth.
Where's that water now?
They're still talking about blood in the chat room, by the way.
Good.
Really got that going. All right. So at that point, let's find out, what did we learn in wrestling this week? Bobby, how about you?
I learned by listening to commentary this week and actually paying attention to what was going on. Vince McMahon is definitely out of touch, and he's in all of the commentators' ears. You know what? You know why I could tell? JBL said that Tyler Breeze looked like a young William Holden.
There's a cat behind Bobby.
We had a dog and a cat running this week.
Shit.
Well, William Holden died in 1981.
Oh, jeez.
Nobody would know who he is, really, besides like Vince McMahon on commentary, I don't think. JBL, maybe. But I think with JBL speaking, you're like Vince speaking through JBL. Like, I know there's like a little parrot.
You're talking like there's an exorcism or something.
Well, I mean, he's in his headset, you know? And there was another thing that he said this week that I was just like, really? Oh, the Sally Jesse Raphael thing, like weeks ago.
The Sally Jesse Raphael one.
Oh, Paige.
Paige is 20 years old and from Britain. From England. She doesn't know who Sally Jesse Raphael is.
Yeah. And I believe both JBL and
Katie's laying down.
and Lawler both had one of the lines of the night.
Okay, now.
From Hell in the Cell.
I'm excited.
When they just both went on a conversation about how, I believe it was Braun Strowman, looked like Mongo from Blazing Saddles.
Yeah.
What the hell?
By the way, Blazing Saddles is a great movie, and everybody should see it.
Yeah, but how many years ago did it come out, Riz?
Older than I am. it's just a weird things to say in the past week.
That's what I learned. Vince is out of touch, which we already knew. So I really didn't learn anything.
Right.
Who's next?
What about you, LB?
I learned that the surest way to get a group of non-wrestling watchers into a wrestling event is the New Day. I watched the pay-per-view with some people who don't watch pay-per-views, really. And that was their favorite thing in the world, was any time Big E was dancing.
Bobby?
It was absolutely fantastic.
Silence for Xavier Woods.
My girlfriend, who had not seen them before, actually sent a message on Facebook that said, New Day rocks. And her mom texted her and said, what is that? And it was all very adorable. So, New Day, Sorg. New Day.
New Day.
Awesome. And from the chat room, or not from the chat room, actually, the chat room, please let us know what you learned as well. But from the Facebook group, they learned... What?
Riz didn't go yet.
Riz didn't go yet?
Riz didn't go
yet. Riz, what'd you learn?
I learned Taker just wanted some tossed salad and scrambled eggs, Sword. That's all he wanted.
Wow.
And they're falling again.
Fraser things are hilarious.
Oh, God.
That Fraser face. The thing is, it doesn't look too far off from how he looks.
even Kane as Niles is just...
The Kane Niles is actually kind of the same face, just angrier.
It is the exact same face.
All right, and I learned, I don't know how the wrestlers do it with these masks, because I can't even podcast without my peripheral vision here. This is getting hard over here. But we'll keep working with this. From the Facebook page, Gabriel learned that WWE is branching out to other companies to work with. The New Japan, apparently they admitted that WWE is putting feelers out to get their footage on the network. I'd love to see that in some capacity. David, this is a new name I haven't recognized. David over there says that WWE isn't going to let the Dudley Boys get the titles anytime soon. Hashtag get the titles. Hashtag New Day sucks. I don't know. After that showing at Hell in a Cell, I don't think they should get it for a little bit. That was kind of a rough one. Mad Mike learned that he's irrationally invested in the career of Devon Taylor. Okay.
She was doing like a gaming thing now too. I saw on Twitter.
Huh?
Down, up, up.
No. Like she was doing like a competitive gaming thing. I forget what it was.
Oh, good. She's getting work.
Yeah, she's good for her.
Good for her. Good for her. She's not bad for like an on-screen personality, but wrestler. Alex Carr is out there in Cali. Learned that it doesn't matter if a promotion holds you back. If the price is right, you'll be back where you belong. But you already knew that.
I see what you did there.
Antonio Garza, our friend from Texas, learned that once again WWE is trying to copy TNA with this Mex-American thing. Such a blatant rip of TNA's Mexican America stable. Is that right?
I don't know much about
TNA. I don't remember the Mexico America stable that they had there.
No, I remember it. It was bad.
Guys, what's a TNA?
I think it was LAX and Chavo Guerrero. I think that was LA. That was the Mex-America.
That's weird.
Or whatever.
That's weird. By the way, Hernandez, thanks for retweeting our stuff on indie wrestling this week. And that led to a huge reply back and forth over on this page. He also learned that Alberto is a money whore that goes back to the abusive boyfriend as soon as they wiggle some money in his face. Wow.
Yeah. Money talks.
I'd say so. Jen Carlin's, a pay-per-view without Dean Ambrose is just as boring Sunday or Monday night. Or pay-per-view or Raw without. It did, but he didn't do anything. He was just like backstage hanging out with his buddy Roman Reigns.
He was there for moral support.
I guess so.
Good thing they helped out The Undertaker when he was in need by the guys they fought. You know, just saying, they're too busy getting drunk. So, you know.
Going for some beers after the show.
That's right. And Kyle learned that Big E is slowly becoming this generation's Norman Smiley. That's okay. That's okay.
The giant wiggle.
Yeah, it is. The part where he like wiggled his hips and then like Roman Reigns reacted to it was kind of the best thing from the night. I'm just like, oh, it's not going to get much better. And it actually got pretty good for the rest of the night. But and also from the Twitters, Ed Burke 37. That's your number. Our Patreon supporter over there. Great matches can at least partially make up for a predictable booking. Well, yeah. I mean, I hope so.
So what if it's predictable booking? As long as it's good.
You know, I'm not getting into that. From the show titles are coming in, guys. I think that's all we got for here. What we learned this week in wrestling. This is getting weird. I feel like I'm hunching over. I don't know. I don't know what's going on with this. I should put my hood up.
Stuff in your head, and it's making you.
It's weighing me down, man. It's weighing me down. Well,
hey, Sword, you should do a lucha at the end of this.
Lucha what?
Lucha.
I don't know. I'm like a Rastafarian lucha. I don't know what if this even works.
Lucha, bruh.
You can steal this gimmick, by the way, if you want this. We got our guest up here. Andrew Palace is in studio. I don't have a camera on him right now, but we're going to work on new. I don't know. The hairstyling, man. I don't know. You think you can pull this off with that hair? Yeah? Yeah. We're going to find out more than just noises with Andrew Palace here on Indie Mayhem Show coming up very soon. You can check us out at WrestlingMayhemShow.com. You subscribe to this and so many other shows on all the outlets, video and audio formats, as well as all of our Facebooks, Twitters, Google Plus, at Mayhem Show on the Twitter, of course. And please hit us up, hashtag WM's Big Question. Hey, if you're on our Twitters in the next couple days in the Pittsburgh area, we are giving away an RIP ticket and a trick-or-treat graphic novel on there, hashtag Pittsburgh Scare, and I think that's it. Hold on, it was just right in front of me, son of a bitch. There it is, hashtag Scare Pittsburgh, and follow at Sorgatron Media for a chance to win those. Tell us your scariest place in Pittsburgh, and that's what we got. And also, please, our Patreon supporters, patreon.com/wrestlingmayhemshow. Join us here live every Tuesday at 9 p.m. Eastern Time at live.wrestlingmayhemshow.com. Big thanks to Missy, wife of the show.
My wife
of the show on Twitter. If you want to talk with her, doing the show notes, community wrangling, and tweets all night long. Thank you. He's at DJ Lunchbox at panelriot.com.
It's true. This week, by the time you hear this, also available will be the new panel Riot with Vertigo writer Asher Powell. She was a pleasure to talk to, and her new book is out today. Go and buy it today. It's fantastic. Check it out at panelriot.com.
There you go. And also, hey, the Riz at the E Riz on the Twitters, mm-hmm, and Riz Plays Games on the YouTube.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Sorg. I'm probably going to be doing a nice little live stream soon of the my career path in WWE 2K16. It's a game, as I mentioned in Boss Battle, which you can hear 8 o'clock, which is directly followed by the Wrestling Mayhem Show.
And also, he's also part of InsertCoinToBegin.com, but so is Bobby F. J-Town.
And I just want to throw out there that Will and I are going to be doing our Extra Life thing on the November 7th, and I think Riz hopefully will join us. Maybe Sorg. Maybe not on that day, but someday soon. And we're going to be raising money for Will, you're doing it for Children's Hospital Pittsburgh.
Yes.
I'm doing it for the Children's Hospital Erie. And we're going to raise money for the kids.
Yep. bit.ly/LBExtra. Go and give anything you can.
Yeah.
There you go. And I'm at Sorgatron on the Twitters. Follow everything SorgatronMedia.com, Sorgatron.com, and all kinds of fun places. Thank you, everybody, for joining us, everybody in the chat room, and everybody around the Mayhem universe. Mayhem out. Just wait. Just wait. Just wait. Just wait. This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at sorgatronmedia.com.